What's up everyone? It's GaijinGamer here, back with episode 6 of How to Be a Noob in King's Raid 2021. Today, we'll be covering early game Soulstones, the additional content in the game, as well as NPC Heroes. So without further ado, let's hop into it. So first up, we'll discuss early game Soulstones and how to utilize them. So first up, after opening the Temple of the God King, we'll go into the King's Sanctum. And as you can see here, we have a red N, which means we have a unique weapon that is able to be unleashed with a soul weapon. So as you can see, I have Lavril's weapon over here, and I have one copy of a soul stone for Lavril. So what we'll do is that we'll go ahead and hit the unleashed soul weapon. But before we do so, we'll just take a look at what we're gaining from opening the soul or unleashing the soul weapon. So as you can see, we're gaining 125,000 max HP, which is pretty awesome for defensive capabilities. We're getting 4,500 attack, which is pretty nice as well, as all of our abilities will scale off attack. And then it has this additional skill effect right here. And that's going to be pretty huge. I recommend that everyone uses their soul stones on their soul stone selector tickets that you get from the central Orville event going on right now on their main DPS, as it's going to give your main DPS the best the best returns and the best efficiency as far as your soul stone use. Alrighty, now after unleashing our soul weapons, as you can see in the King's Sanctum here, we have a couple more options to choose from. So advancing soul weapon, I'll just briefly cover this as it won't be used too much free to play as well as early game. What this is once you've reached ether enhancement plus 5, which we'll cover in just a second, as well as have two additional soul stones of a specific character after awakening it for the first time, you can go from advancement phase 0 to advancement phase 1. What this does is increases the base stats. As you can see, it doubles up, as well as it will give the unique skill that it gives a bonus effect once advancing it to phase 1. So we'll just kind of keep moving on, as you know, you probably won't use that too much early game. Next, we'll cover ether enhancement. Now, what ether enhancement does is it progressively increases the power of your soul weapon, as well as it allows you to advance the phases of your soul weapon further down the line. As you can see, to advance to phase 1, we needed a plus 5 weapon. Our weapon is currently plus 0, as stated right here. And to level it up, we'll use these orb currencies shown right here. There's also a blue orb currency, which is technically less than all of these. It's kind of in order. It goes blue, purple, red, yellow. And they'll give varying amounts of EXP. Now, something to note, while you're trying to advance the phase of your ether enhance your weapon, is that from phase 1 to 5 of ether enhancement, if you use the blue currency, it will give you the lowest amount of EXP. However, once you hit level 5 of ether enhancement, it's no longer available for use. So what I would recommend to be most efficient with your ether is go ahead and use all blue orbs, if possible, until you hit ether enhancement level 5. This might take a while, but in the end, it will give you the best diminishing returns as far as your currency goes. And then, I'll just kind of explain how this works real quick. See, as I've got some orbs selected, and as you can see, I went ahead and hit the max button here. And what we'll do is we would hit add ether, and then we would hit attempt enhancement. And as you can see, the current success rate is 100%, but as you gain higher within the ether, ether enhancement level, it's going to reduce that chance. However, you can always max it. It's just going to require additional gold and resources to do so. So something to keep in mind. Alrighty, and prior to moving on to managed soul weapon, I'd just like to mention that the ether enhancement gets extremely expensive, especially as a free-to-play or early game player. Just be careful that the amount of gold that you're trying to spend for ether enhancement will not hinder you trying to transcend your characters all the way up to T5, as that's also somewhat expensive. Luckily, we have an event going on, so it will hopefully help a little bit, but ether enhancement gets extremely expensive, so just watch out. Now, moving on to managed soul weapon. As you can see from here, there's a few things that it has at the bottom, as well as some information over here. Now, One thing to keep in note, or the key points from this menu, are the rearrange stats option right here. Now, what this allows us to do, as you can see, we have currently 50% attack and 50% HP on this soul weapon. What we can do is we can hit the rearrange stats. Luckily, I have some rearranged soul weapon tickets, and this is going to randomly reroll the attack and HP percentages. And as you can see here, after doing so, we've got 60.2% attack and 39.8% HP. And on your main DPS, you're definitely going to want more attack on than HP. So if you happen to roll more HP, do not take the roll. I would stick with the 50-50. Because the more damage you have, the more attack you have, the more damage you'll do, and the more damage your skills will do, and it will just ramp up your damage quite insanely. I do recommend rearranging the stats, at least until you get something above 60% on your attack for your main DPS. So moving on, the other thing that it has is it shows you what the additional skills for the advancement phases are. However, as a newer player, it's not too important, but they're just down there just in case you want to know. Moving on, we have the Soul Judgment in the King Sanctum menu here. Now what this does is it allows to roll this currency up here, the Mystical Soul Fragments, in order to randomly roll for Soul Stones or the Orbs. Now, what you would do if you had enough currency is you would just click on this icon in his hand, and it's a 20% chance to get a soul stone. And if you don't happen to get it, it's going to give you an orb, an ether orb randomly, whether it be purple, red, or yellow. I do not believe it can give you blue from this method right here. And then if you're lucky, you'll get a soul stone. Now, one thing to keep in mind, if you're lucky enough to have what's called Protection of the God King down here, you are going to be in luck, because what that does is normally you would get a completely random soul stone if you were to roll with these mystical fragments. However, this Protection of the God King will allow you to choose from three separate soul stones. So as an early game or free-to-play player, there's ways to obtain these in the quests and various missions in the game. I would recommend only rolling if you have these protections, so keep in mind. That way at least you have somewhat of a chance to get a soul stone for one of the characters that you may be using. But even then, there's 100 heroes in the game, so good luck. I wish you all very good luck, because these are hard to get. Also, if you happen to fail to get a soul stone, what it's going to do is going to keep raising this royal gift counter up by 1 each time. And once you hit 20 out of 20, it's going to automatically pity you a soul stone. And it can also proc your Protection of the God King, so keep in mind. Alrighty. So next thing in the Temple of the God King, we have the Trials of the God King. Now this will get us our currency for the mystical fragments, as well as some soulstone materials for specific classes. As you can see below, the trials are paired off via class. The Trial of Earth has Knight and Warrior, the Trial of Sky has Rogue, Archer, Mechanic, and the Trial of Flow has Mage and Priest. Now, prior to jumping these trials, one thing I would like to recommend is that you definitely open the trial associated with your main DPS. That way you can start collecting fragments to start building class-specific soulstones for your main DPS. As you can see, I'm running Rebel Class, so I went ahead and opened the Trial of Earth over here. Now, one thing to keep in mind, the Trial of Earth, you'll want to bring a lot of stuns, the Trial of Sky, you'll want to bring a lot of AoE DPS, and the Trial of Flow, you'll want to bring just a lot of heals and heal reductions, as the boss tends to heal. Something to keep in mind as well is that these dungeons get extremely difficult, so just try to do as high of a rank as possible, and just work your way up as you get a first clear bonus, just shown off to the left here. And good luck. All right, now moving on, we have the world boss. And what I recommend as an early player, what you do for the world boss is enter in daily, as your team's going to be gaining power drastically every single day. And what I just recommend is just to throw in your best team possible once you get ready for battle, and just auto the battle and see how much damage you can do. Because as you do increased damage, it's going to unlock rubies the more damage that you are able to do to the boss. So that's what I'd recommend for World Boss, and I wouldn't recommend getting too in-depth with it, especially in the early game. Next up, we have the Tower of Challenge, and what I recommend is more or less the same thing, is to put your best team forward, as you can see here, hit the start battle, and then hit the continuous option battle. And from there, it's just going to keep autoing all the way up until you fail the mission or until you fail the level. And then it's going to give you these artifact currency to be able to restore artifacts. And it's just something to keep in mind that you want to do as this Tower of Challenge does reset, I think once a month. So be careful and make sure you do that before it resets. Alrighty, and now we'll move on to Eclipse. Now Eclipse, I would not recommend doing that often. As you can see, we have five entries right here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And as you can see, I've used one already. Now, the reason why I do not recommend using all of your attempts right away is because these recharge extremely slowly. But what this will do is the further you progress within the Eclipse challenge here, what I would recommend is just putting your best team forward. But the further you can get, the more ethers you get to ether enhance your weapon further down the line in order to just, you know, power up your soul weapons, essentially. That's where this material comes from. But I would recommend holding off on doing all of your attempts because your characters, especially in the beginning as an early player, you're gaining so much account progression and your characters are just drastically increasing in power every single day. But these recharge about once in 5 days, or depending on how much stamina you use, as well as it gives you a little chunk every single day. So I would just hold off and sparingly use these. The first time that I'd ever use a attempt on this is actually when you get to mission 12 on the beginner's jumping orders right here, is to complete an eclipse battle. As you see, that's the one that I did, and you want to strategically use these. But until then, until they cap out, I wouldn't use any additional eclipse battles. Now finally, the last thing I'd like to cover in the additional content phase of this video is the guild raid, as shown right here. One thing that you'll have to do first off is join a guild. But then second off, once you do, you'll have this available to you. And what you'll do is you'll have 4 entries to put forth your best team and fight these guild bosses. As you can see, you've got several ones right here, and you're able to clear them as you kind of go down. Now, just something to keep in mind that each of these bosses have a different mechanic. So you can look in the info to see what, you know, the recommended heroes are, some skill infos, and, you know, the rewards for, you know, clearing as well as just doing some damage to these bosses. I highly recommend this as it gives your guild some progression towards leveling up, as well as B, it will give you some pretty awesome rewards. So just make sure to use all of your guild raid attempts. Alrighty, now moving on to the last thing we'll cover today, which is NPC heroes. So as you can see, we're shopping with our girl May, and she's got the present icon in the bottom right. So we'll go ahead and click that, and what it'll do is just bring us into the friendship menu right here. And as you can see, I have a few friendship gifts already. And what we'll do is we'll just click on one, we would hit the max if I'm intending to get May, and then we hit the present icon. Now what that would do is it would increase your friendship, as you can see, 30,000 out of 100,000. And once we hit that 100,000, we'd actually receive the 4-star hero, May. Now, something to keep in mind is once you receive the hero, the friendship level will actually reduce down to 0, and you can go through a second time to then get that NPC's unique weapon. Now that's important as NPC unique weapons are extremely hard to get, so just keep in mind. Another thing that you would get from obtaining the hero the first time through is you'll actually get discounts depending on where you're at and which store that you're shopping with. So for example, May would give you discounts on all of her goods, Loman would give you discounts on the world boss icons. Now just really quick, I'm just going to give you some recommendations for who I'd recommend, depending on if you're rolling magical or physical. If you're rolling magical, I definitely recommend our girl May. She's not only a strong buffer, but a strong healer and used all over the place on magical teams and endgame content. Now, physical teams, depending if you have Shock May, if not, I would recommend going Loman because he's an awesome choice. He's top tier along with Shock May, and just something to think about if you happen to like the way he looks and stuff like that. I mean, he's got a pretty BA polar arm right there. But personally, so the next option that I have for physical teams is Gladdy. Now, he's a sub DPS damage dealer. He has great amps and he does great damage. So that's personally why I'll be going for him, and something you may want to consider if you already have Shock May. And then the last one I would recommend for a physical team is the healer Juno. Now she's great, however she's kind of fallen off to the likes of Fallen Frey as well as some of the other healers. I mean, Estelle is even probably better than her nowadays, But hey, if you like cooking or if you like the way she looks, she may be a great option for you. So, yeah. Those are all of the NPC heroes, how to obtain them. What we'll cover real quickly is just how to get some of the additional items to give to your friendship. One of the ways to do that is go into the shop here and just buy these Dragon's Kinship boxes from the raid coins here. And those are great because they will help expedite the process for you getting your NPC hero. Another way to do that is go into the mission tab and then go into growth. And then scroll all the way down, and as you can see, there's an NPC tab right here. And if you follow these missions, you'll obtain a ton of bracelets, thus even expediting your progress for obtaining heroes even more so. So yeah, without further ado, that wraps it up for this video. I'm GaijinGamer, signing out.